typing it. Okay, I'll begin. I think we're ready to begin. Hello and welcome, and thank you for joining our second Art Criticism and the Pandemic Lunchtime Talk. I'm Chris McCormack, Associate Editor at Art Monthly, and many of the issues that we discussed yesterday and today are born out of issues raised in the magazine over the last several issues. Indeed, many of the invited speakers have contributed or appeared in the magazine, or who I've worked with during residencies and workshops. For those who don't know the magazine, please take time to look it up and support independent publishing by subscribing. I would first like to thank the Paul Mellon Centre for supporting these talks, and to Anna Reed, who is Head of Research at the Centre, for chairing yesterday's talk, and Events Manager Ella Fielding for organising these events. Sincere thanks. I propose these talks to the PMC from a shared need to start conversations about writing and the pandemic, but also to look more critically at the discourse surrounding it. I think we're all conscious of not wanting to participate in a discourse of excitement, of opportunities that may have arisen around what is disproportionately affecting and killing people of colour, those in care homes, and the vulnerable in society. Today's talk, titled Whose Body, seeks to continue some of yesterday's conversation, analysing the intersections of ableism, racial injustice, and sedimentations of colonial violences, and to consider these from more closely from perspectives of representation and visibility, structures of care, the rights to living and mourning, and the damaging consequences of an increasing privatisation of healthcare. The discussion today seeks to analyse, critique, and propose new paths of resistance. As I say, we have an incredible lineup of speakers today, coming from many places. Neo Zanazolo Musangi, who is joining from Kajiado in Kenya. Robert McRuer, who's joining from Bogota. Lon Absigogati and Marina Vishnit, both who are in London. And Jade Montserrat, who is joining from Scarborough. I'll introduce each in more detail as they give their papers. In terms of structure, which I briefly outlined before, Neo and Lon will speak first, followed by discussion, followed by Robert and Marina with Q&A, and then Jade, followed by Q&A. So please do send questions using the Q&A box, which can be found by clicking at the bottom of the page or by raising your hand, and we'll unmute your mic so that you can speak directly to the panel. So this brings me to announce our first speaker, Neo Zanazolo Musangi. I'm so pleasured to see you. Your power's here. You're here with us. An independent queer feminist whose work life is in art, academia, and creative writing. Between 2013 and early 2017, Neo was the Humanities Research Fellow at the British Institute in Eastern Africa in Kenya. Before then, Neo had acquired a doctoral fellowship at the Wits Institute for Social and Economic Research at the University of the Witwatersrand in Johannesburg. They now work as a maker of things and who also writes about art when they cannot make it. They also double up as a part-time lecturer in gender studies at St. Lawrence University and is currently working on a collection of essays titled Public Sex, Failure and Postcolonial Mediocrity in the Biographical Archive. Neo lives in Kajiado, Kenya, as I say, with their three Maasai Shepherd dog children, Kabelo, Ratimi and Loretto. It is my pleasure to announce and introduce Neo. If you may want to start.
Thank you, Chris. I'm really excited to be here. I feel slightly unprepared for this, but we'll see how it goes. So my conversation today is around something that I'm calling Black insistence. And I don't think I will speak much about art writing or even art making in this conversation, but I want to draw on very general ideas about Blackness. So when I submitted this topic, I had many things to say, things that could have counted as brilliant or at least thought through. I realize now it is difficult to speak about Blackness and being in the face of something now being called a pandemic. But this difficulty is mostly because of fear, the fear of not only sounding polemic, but also the fear of succumbing into native informant oversharing. It is difficult to do thinking work from the place that has come to be known as Africa in this moment. I deliberately use Africa and not Kenya, my specific context, because this positioning is important to situate where I speak from, where I was born into and where I live, a place that seems to live in or with pandemics. from cholera, HIV, Ebola, and poverty, if we think of poverty as a pandemic. Africa is the home of diseased bodies. And I don't even see this as an oversimplification. To many, this is a tautology, but it's worth restating nevertheless. This is one way of making myself and the bodies about which I speak intelligible. In a different context, I probably wouldn't need to do this, but we are speaking of a disease. We are speaking about bodies, diseased or likely to be diseased bodies. And as Elaine Scarry calls it, the body in pain. Just this week, the South African government was reported to have prepared, or at least to have been in the process of preparing, approximately 1.5 million graves in Gauteng province alone. This is amidst increasing COVID-19 statistics across the continent, with more than 12,000 deaths registered, and with most of these in South Africa as of yesterday. There's something to be said about the digging of graves being seen as government preparedness here. It is both an admission of inevitability, but also an indexing to something larger. Bandile Masuku, a Gauteng provincial official, matter-of-factly says, it's a reality that we need to deal with. Masuku is probably right. As the numbers ascend, many Africans living on the continent will certainly die. And this is not about pessimism. It is an acknowledgement of the continent's place in the world. A vaccine for COVID-19 will be found. But like the HIV vaccine, it may take 5 years or perhaps even up to 20 for that vaccine to reach and become accessible to Africa's 1.3 billion people. By then, other pandemics will have broken out and Africa will be dealing with not only HIV and SARS-2 and its many mutations, but a whole range of other complications. The reasons for these are obvious. Pandemics, history has shown us, become one of many sites that encapsulate the regulation of biomedicine through the vicissitudes of social normativities. Like what's the case with HIV/AIDS in the late 1990s and in the early part of the last decade, William Spaulding reports, and I quote, some global health officials argued that those living in poverty were not literate enough to follow the prescribed regimen of treatment for taking ARV medication. This racist argument, in turn, Spaulding continues, was appropriated by Western pharmaceutical companies as a rationale for not lowering the cost of the drugs, arguing that a failure to take the drugs responsibly could lead to drug-resistant strains of HIV. I do not want to dwell on the racism of biomedical knowledge here, but it is important to think in the larger frame of these histories as a way through which Black African bodies continue to be not only last in the hierarchy of bodily cartographies, but also as disposable, as not yet quite human, as undeserving. If they do not die of COVID-19 MS, they will die of some other specifically African problem anyway. And if they are not dying of COVID-19 as fast as expected, Western journalists implore everyone else quite suggestively to wonder why. African countries are poor, and African governments cannot be trusted fast enough to save lives. To many on the continent, or it's probably me and a few others, COVID-19 has the ill feeling of, quote unquote, we've been here before, or even, quote, but we live here. But I want to go back to the idea of the human, and perhaps dwell on it for the rest of this talk. In a different talk this week, I was exploring the double negation that posts many Black people across the world as neither human nor citizen. And not in the sense of battler's recognizability, but as accepted subjects of the state that can be eliminated by the police and other agents at will. In Kenya, for instance, with the ongoing curfew and lockdown, afraid of, as it is the fear of being beaten or killed by the police. This is happening at a time when blackness seems to have garnered currency and entered the lexicon of the human in light of the Black Lives Matter movement, as though blackness, as in always, lived in this combustible rage. We were never human. And I use we strategically here. We have never fully been able to participate in sociality of what has come to be known as the human. The human in human evolution, the human in human rights, I dare say, and indeed the human in human beings. We know this because, as Sadia Hartman reminds us in Sins of Subjugation, the black body is in ontological opposition to the very definition of humanity around which human rights, civil society, or even the rule of law, for example, are defined. Of course, many black scholars have found this black personhood vis-a-vis black interpolation framing pessimistic and even at times unuseful in the extreme. Indeed, this framework is seen as overly overemphasizing the antagonism between blackness and humanity to the point that it reduces black subjectivity to a death-driven non-being, as Fred Moten is wont to argue. I can imagine the possibility that possibly a huge number of people here would agree with this critique, and that's understandable, as black subjecthood seems to be simply a byproduct of racial slavery and black agency when or if at all possible is inescapably reduced to the replication of the social structure, the Brazilian scholar Jamie Amparo Alves tells us. Now, this ontological position of blackness as antonymous to humanity, Fred Moten has argued, it works in a negative register and ends up denying black subjectivity and reifying black suffering. In its place, Moten suggests that what he calls the para-ontological disruption of the racial script. But then, what is to be done with the historical considerations of negation? Perhaps this is how to conveniently use Sylvia Winter's up for the territory. And I'm suggesting something here. I'm suggesting that we post black insistence as a way of black being, as a way to, as Tabir's Olajuwon has called it, to think blackly. To think blackly as a testimony against governments, as a testimony of black people against police and individuals who strike blows against black bodies and communities in economic and truly corporeal terms. I'm calling for a sightedness that makes black living and living while black possible now and beyond. And I want to conclude this very unfinished thoughts with one, a line from June Jordan's poem, A Poem for Nana. And June Jordan asks, what will we do when there's nobody left to kill? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nao, for that amazing discussion of life in Africa and your position in there. I will move on to Lan before we have a more open discussion between the two papers. Lan, if you could share your screen and we'll then have a group discussion about both papers.
Sure. Thank you to Chris for inviting me and Paul Mellon Center for hosting and to Nao for that really interesting talk. I'm going to talk about painting, recent painting, and particularly figuration, and the relationship of this to questions around the body and the sort of politics of the body. Now, before I share my screen, I just sort of wanted to frame how I'm approaching this, which is through the way in which over the last, I would say, maybe 2 or 3 years, the majority of painting that I've engaged with and seen, both in galleries, or recent painting, I should say, as well as at work on behalf of the work that students at the Slade, where I work and making, seems to be dominated by figurative painting, which obviously stands in some kind of contrast to the way in which painting developed at least in the sort of dominant centers of the art world through much of the 20th century after the beginnings of modernism. And I want to think about this through how some of the criticisms of recent abstraction have revolved around this category of zombie formalism, which was put forth by the critic Walter Robinson, where he saw this category of zombie formalism as kind of marking the last gasp of abstraction as a kind of viable or interesting in and of itself way of making work, where abstraction in the form of zombie formalism becomes merely decoration for corporate lobbies. Now that figurative painting has become so ubiquitous in the way that it has in recent years, my friend Lizzie sent me an article yesterday by the critic Alex Greenberg, which is titled something like Zombie Figuration. So using the same category to describe the trend and its popularity with curators, collectors, and artists. So with zombie obviously standing here in a kind of metaphoric way for something that is sort of ubiquitous and undead. I would really like to have sort of framed this a little bit more, but in a kind of related to some of the questions about what a zombie body is in relation to a pandemic and the undead. But I'm just taking up this category to think through what that idea of zombie figuration might mean, and particularly some of the limits of that idea that I feel instinctively in terms of the fact that recent figurative practice seems particularly concerned with questions around representation, race, gender, and sexuality in a way which instinctively makes me feel it's less hospitable to this zombification or this kind of banal ubiquity that we would associate with zombie formalism. So I want to do this through thinking about some paintings that I saw this year before the lockdown, which I will run through now. So I'm just gonna start the share screen thing. And hopefully everyone can see my slides now. So this is Kerry James Marshall's painting, part of a series that he made, which center on themes of Black romance and take their form from the Fragonard painting, The Swing. So if this Fragonard painting marks a kind of like apotheosis of a French aristocratic, like Rococo frivolity, Marshall reframes it to include symbols around Black militancy and resistance. So I don't know if I don't know how I can sort of point out, but hopefully you can see the fist on top of the Afro comb in the back. And in other paintings within this series, there's other sorts of symbols that reference that history. So I saw this at the Art Institute of Chicago, and on that same visit, I also saw Yutta Kotter's A Bar at Number 5, which, I'm sorry, this is a very poor slide, I now realize, but this painting riffs off Manet's very famous bar at the Folies Bergères. So in the case of both Kotter and Kerry James Marshall, they are engaging in a kind of figurative painting to refer back to the history of painting. Also in February in New York, I saw Jordan Castile's show at the New Museum, which engages with the history of figurative painting, particularly within modernism through her engagement with forms of realism. Many of her paintings made me think about Alice Neal's work and Charles White's work. So something like Alice Neal's portraits that she made in Spanish Harlem in the 50s, or in relation to this painting by Jordan Castile of a nail technician at work. I was thinking about some of Charles White's paintings from the 50s, portraits of workers, such as this one. And in that sort of representing people at work, it seems to resonate with some of the historical preoccupations with realism. This painting is one I've thought about quite a lot in the last couple of weeks as I've followed some discussion mainly online on behalf of like on Instagram, seeing kind of nail technicians complaining about the fact, or complaining is the wrong way to put it, but criticizing the fact that the government in the UK has, you know, obviously opened up bars and restaurants and so on from the lockdown now, but the beauty industry remains kind of shut down for the minute, aside from hairdressers. And many of these women have been pointing at the fact that this has a kind of racist and sexist undercurrent to it, in that the beauty industry is mainly staffed by and managed, owned by women of colour in the UK. So thinking through these portraits by Jordan Castile as engaged with some of the principles of realism, and the idea of the portrait in particular as having a kind of humanizing device. So Alice Neal described paintings like these as part of what she called a proletarian portrait gallery, and the aim of them being to kind of represent subjects that were up to that point largely excluded from the history of Western painting. And in some ways I would see Castile's painting as continuing in that tradition. Also earlier this year I saw Nicole Eisenman's painting Brooklyn Beer Garden at the Whitechapel Radical Figures Show, which in its own sort of capacity raised questions about what does the word radical mean in relation to painting like this, or figurative painting. What does radical mean in relation to politics when it's situated here, or in relation to aesthetics? But as much as Castile engages, I think, with histories of realism, Eisenman is also engaged in histories of 20th century figurative painting, particularly stuff around Neue Sachlichkeit. Something like this by Otto Dietz comes to mind. So I'm making these references towards how these painters are engaged with the history of figurative painting and modernism. It's not to suggest that these works are less or derivative in any way, but rather to think about how these artists engage in legacies of paintings which mark the history of modernism, and what that might mean in relation to the idea of zombie figuration. So rather than thinking about these paintings or the intention of the painters as somehow undead, I would rather suggest that the zombie quality arises in relation to the history of modernism. So it's more the history that this work chooses to engage that remains undead, and in particular, the modes of exclusion which were foundational to that history of modernism. I now want to come on to works that have kind of intrigued me, for better or worse, that seem less self-consciously engaged with history or the canon. And firstly, I would like to come to Noah Davis's paintings, whose work I saw all over Instagram, which raises other questions about how we're looking at painting during a pandemic. And while I thought they looked interesting on the screen, I didn't quite get it until seeing them in person, where his show at David's Ferner in New York really knocked me out. Particularly because these paintings, I don't know exactly what to relate them to in terms of a history of figurative painting. If anything, what they reminded me of was more recent film or television. They made me think about Jordan Peele's movies Us or Get Out, in terms of a kind of black gothic or black horror aesthetic, and also Donald Glover's TV show Atlanta, for the way that they mix domesticity, familial relations with a kind of edge of risk or danger, but I think in a totally different way to how that kind of uncanny domesticity might have been executed within surrealism. And these paintings are still works that I'm thinking about a lot and trying to figure out what they're doing. Similarly, Hamishi Farah's show at Arcadia Missa, I think I saw this at the end of March. I really liked this painting a lot for the way in which it takes up quite an odd but unlikely, like a kind of unlikely scene of a moment in a vet's of this dog having some kind of, I don't know, procedure. But there's something about the caption and the way it's framed that seems filtered very much through a screen, through Instagram, the kind of focus on the animal, but the animal here is kind of pathetic or damaged. And yeah, so as much as I feel like I don't know how to think about Noah Davis's work in relation to the history of sort of tropes within modernist figurative painting, Hamishi Farah's work also seems to me like completely unusual and interesting. Finally, I wanted to come on to work that to me seems a little bit closer to how I would understand a zombie figuration, which also raises questions about sort of subjecthood and bodies, and that is through the work of T.M. Davie. So he's a painter based in New York, and while some of the sort of painterly techniques that we see here seem close to Farah's painting is acrylic, this is gouache, and pastel, so they're both using materials that in some way are like less valuable than say oil painting in terms of the history of painting. And while this is of course also a painting of a dog, I don't really know what this is other than just a painting of a dog, whereas the Hamishi Farah painting seems much more kind of intriguing. But Davie's work has more than this sort of paintings of dogs or animals, has become mainly known for his portrayals of romance, gay romance, and life on Fire Island. And this, of course, comes back to the question of recognition, figuration, subjectivity that is also running through much of the other work that I have shown today. In a recent article by Barry Schwabsky, which is called What's Wrong with the New Figurative Painting, he has an aside about gay marriage and some of these paintings by Davie, as well as other artists, and is thinking about this in terms of like what painting demands or representation demands in terms of sort of asking for a form of recognition and how we could think about that alongside something like gay marriage. And this idea of recognition and representation in the eyes of the law, of course, raises then questions about what the sort of overwhelming earnestness, as I would see it, in Davie's paintings excludes. So the critic Shiv Kotecha wrote the following about Davie's paintings of scenes from Fire Island, saying this, and I'll just quote him. He says, despite my desires, I cannot shake the feeling that the cruisy fantasies of isolation from New York City, from the straight world that enable a sense of queer freedom, rely on quiet and unshakable forms of racial exclusion. Is the anonymity of cruising in the dunes or woods or on the island's elevated gangways just another kind of ethnic erasure? I can never be anonymous in Pines. Its predominant whiteness forbids it. So thinking about that, while I think like considering the sort of range of figurative painting practices that we see today, it would be completely absurd to pose it in the terms that it was sometimes posed within the history of the 20th century and modernism as like incipiently regressive, especially when abstraction has now become the default mode of art for corporate lobbies the world over. There are, of course, many different registers here. And at a time where bodies and visibility is and portraiture and representation is profoundly uneven and riddled with violence, it seems worth thinking through some of these contradictions or differences. In putting these thoughts together very quickly this morning, and I'm sorry if it's a little bit rushed what I'm saying, I kept thinking about this quote from Philip Guston, I think it's from sort of mid-70s, where he said, I see the studio as a court. The act of painting is like a trial where all the roles are lived by one person. It's as if the painting has to prove its right to exist. This quote, I think, dates after Philip Guston's sort of scandalous return to figuration, which he was heavily criticized within the New York art world in the early 70s. But it's of course worth noting that when he returned to making figurative work for Guston, it was related to the political exigencies of the moment. So in 1971, he starts making his kind of hideous cartoons of Richard Nixon. The court is of course an odd metaphor to justify the existence of the painting, which as we know it, the court remains a space of relentless injustice, while it claims to always be a space of justice. But nevertheless, the idea of why an artwork needs to exist, other than to provide decoration for rich people's homes, remains a question, I think, to explore around this rise of figuration. And I will end there. Let me stop sharing.
Thanks, Lan. And that contribution, I think it really opens up the many parallel worlds that we are living through, and compared to Neo's text and the conversation, if Neo can open up the camera again and we can have a conversation. Is Nao still there? Everyone?
Yes, I am.
Great. Nao, I will briefly begin. I think you mentioned the subject, this idea of thinking blackly. And I think in a way that seemed to me like one point where we could actually maybe engage with your conversation in a broader point. I mean, I think the discussion of, you know, it's incredible to describe the situation of this expectation of death and these digging of graves. But can we talk a little bit about this idea of maybe thinking blackly in relationship to that and maybe what that proposes in some way, if that can be even thought about?
Thanks, Chris. I think at the risk of sounding very defeatist, and I think a lot of Black scholars, especially now in this moment, have come to a conclusion that perhaps Blackness was not going to ever be human, right? Historically, and in this moment, that there's this insistence to be included. Mm. And what that does, it creates a conversation around diversity that becomes something to do with the politics of representation, right? And I think to think blackly for me, as Sadia Hartman, as Sylvia Winter, as so many other Black women have said, is to actually think from a place of a care ethic, right? It's to speak from where I am standing, rather than do what Toni Morrison has wonders against, like rather than speak back, rather than insist on being included in this human community, to actually start figuring out ways of surviving, right, from here and from within that Blackness. And this is not to ask for Black exceptionalism. I think what I'm thinking through is how else can we live, right, rather than spending a lot of energy fighting to be part of a community that doesn't consider us part of that community, if that makes sense.
I completely nail it. I think it very much does make sense. I wondered if anyone else had thoughts here on any of Nao's conversation or point that were raised. I can see, I don't think we have any questions just there, but Lon, raising some of the subjects you're describing, this idea of almost this undead and this kind of, I guess, this return of the modernist frame that underpins the practices of many present artists. It seems to me this uneasy history that keeps reappearing and won't go away. And is it, in a sense, do you think these artists are trying to certainly not re-energize it, but in a sense dissolve it? Or what is the process behind this re-engagement with this narratives or these histories?
Thanks, Chris. I don't have like one answer to that, but I think in relation to what Nao just said, and to try and sort of make a link with their presentation and what I've just said, I think this question of like representation or recognition is one that interests me a lot, and probably partly why for me the Noah Davis paintings out of the work that I showed seemed most intriguing, because they seem to operate beyond, although like my association with them actually goes to sort of film and television in some way, or even music, it goes to other sorts of cultural forms. So it's not like they're completely outside of a framework of thinking about culture. I find the way in which they seem to like elude or evade some of these more familiar histories of modernism really interesting in terms of some of the problems about portraiture and the history of portraiture, and even the impulse, you know, within Neil's painting, or as I would see it in some of Jordan Castile's painting, that in being about representation and recognition, like how is that linked with this point that Nao has made about the sort of problems around a politics of inclusion, I guess, and where that leaves us when the kinds of frames that you're you know seeking to humanize the subject in relation to are like founded upon dehumanization, which, yeah, so that's, I suppose, how I would respond to that.
And Naya, I wanted to ask, it might seem if this is a question or not relevant, but what do you feel, how have artists responded to the situation, and what's your observations of certain artists that you know? What's the conversation been for you about this subject or the present moment?
I don't have a complete frame of thinking through this, but I think from experience, as particularly in Kenya, where a lot of visual artists seem to work in what is known as the gig economy, I think one of the implications of COVID-19 is that people just don't have work, right? Or that people don't have money. And it seems like we've gone to a survival mode where, for instance, the Kenyan government is trying to put out some money as COVID relief for artists. But then what that means is that artists are expected to produce work that directly relates to COVID-19. And I think a lot of us know that that's not how creative energies work. You don't summon them to speak to a particular thing because people are trying to figure out ways of surviving. There are a lot of people in the last 2 weeks who have been evicted by their landlords just because they can't afford to have rent. And these are artists who do not have galleries, artists who rely on, you know, kind of a pseudo commissioning of work to survive. So it's the situation at the moment. And I think this is a feeling that is shared a lot in the country at the moment, is that it's not COVID-19 itself that is messy. It is the implications of COVID-19 in the economy. It is the implications of coronavirus for even social movement and mobility that is disturbing.
Completely. And as you say, it's, I think for me, it is this image of Africa, as you said, as this diseased corpus in a sense. And in a way, I feel like your argument is kind of, let's change that, or not change, but to kind of move that argument away, as you said, to think blackly. Does that seem a fair comment? Yeah. Anyone else have any thoughts about Naya's text or Lan's text, for that matter? No?
Question in the Q&A box from Julia. It might be good to ask. Julia Smith. Should I read that? Thank you for a very rich prompt, Neo. I was wondering if you could say a bit more about what it might mean from your perspective to think blackly in the specific context of the coronavirus pandemic. So I guess it's something that you've in part already addressed, but.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, Julia, I was just responding in the chat box to your question, but I do not have at the moment a response. I do not have a response to this, particularly because, to be honest, it's very difficult to think with coronavirus at the moment, because in the moment of it, right, and the fact that the numbers have gone so high on the continent, it's becoming increasingly difficult for me to think as it happens, right? And I think to think blackly in a specific context is to maybe perhaps, and perhaps this is a conversation that black people themselves would have to have, and black Africans in this case, to have amongst themselves to figure out whether there are alternative ways of mitigating the pandemic in terms of just, whether it's indigenous knowledges, whatever it is, that resources that are available to them, to tap into them in ways that sustain life. For instance, we know for sure that governments are not going to be what saves our lives, because African governments are what they are. And we do not expect that. But also to think about how
in the context of this pandemic, there are people who have always been lower in the hierarchy in the specific countries. So trans bodies, bodies with disabilities are always going to, the pandemic is going to affect them a lot more than the general population. So there's something to be said about trying to reorganize society, and maybe that's overly ambitious, to reorganize society so that everyone is saved, but in very, I don't want to use inherent, but in ways that come from a knowing that is embedded in Blackness.
And quickly, just to follow up, I would want to add something about the way in which gender roles, actually, and Lan, you picked up on the way in which women's work effectively has been most affected through the pandemic and the process of the pandemic. And that's something that you picked up on. And also, I see that Lizzie Homishan has also posted a question to you, Lan. She says, I wonder if you've been thinking about the status of painting in relation to the subject of the artist and the painting's value is being determined by an emphasis on the artist's labor. She says, I'm thinking here of Isabel Greve's argument here at High Price, as well as how the painting circulates. Painting's reliance on the museum for its value as predicated on exclusivity and the rare chance, and now more than previously, of viewing a painting in person.
Thanks, Lizzie. I think I haven't thought, I mean, I'm not totally convinced by the arguments about artist labor in, from what I know of, like how Isabella Groff like proposes those in terms of like how she understands labor. But the thing that in terms of subjectivity, I guess I've been thinking about this, like particularly with someone like with the TM Davy paintings, like, I don't have another example right now, but how they sort of represent certain like characters or figures, or like summon up an idea of a scene, and how that relates to sort of the presentation of certain subject positions online, or how kind of clout or like value, not in a kind of like strict sense, but I mean like a sort of social value gets accredited to certain people. So I don't think I'd see it so much in terms of in thinking about the status of painting in relation to the subjectivity of the artist. I think I've been thinking about it more in terms of like how the persona of the artist contributes to the value or presence of an artwork, perhaps. I mean, this is nothing new in some ways, but it seems sort of accelerated through the way in which things circulate online and get linked into certain sorts of scenes or personalities in a way that's like much more accessible to everybody rather than how it would have been in the past, where you would have maybe had to, I don't know, like read a certain magazine or go to a certain place, but this is now very, very visible. So that's more how I've thought about it. But yeah, shall I answer the other question that came in the Q&A as well?
Yes, quickly, if you could answer that, that would be
awesome. So how seriously should we take it? I don't know. I mean, it's. I think it's mainly, it's like a piece of rhetoric. And I don't, in the same way that I don't, you know, I'm kind of not so clear on how useful even zombie formalism was as a term beyond a sort of rhetorical device. But it for me, it's useful in terms of thinking that if there's a sort of mainstream critical rhetoric that's reached the point where zombie figuration gets deployed as a term, then it highlights the real dominance of figurative painting within the art world. So it's more useful as a sort of symptomatic thing than actually a serious concept for me right now. But I had a question for Neo, which, can I ask that now? Which was around like whether in terms of what you've been thinking about, I feel like towards problems that emerge, you know, the problems that dominate within the left or political struggles around a lack of internationalism, that particularly within Anglophone contexts, but other contexts, that there's a diminishing of internationalist thinking in terms of political struggle. And I wonder if you have any thoughts on that, or the sort of viability of that now in relation to what you're thinking about, whether it's something you think might shift, is it even something that would be useful, or those sorts of questions.
So, I don't know about diminishing internationalism, but I think just as you were speaking now, one of the things that I've realized is that with airports closed, we are stuck here with each other, right? So the country that I come from Kenya, we rely pretty much on tourism. So I live in the Nairobi National Park, and there are lions roaming around, and I've been wondering, oh, poor lions, they're not tourists to see them, right? Just ask the natives and our lions. And that means in terms of our Kenya's GDP, there's not going to be much coming in, right, for this year. And that has implications for the way that, I mean, we don't have a government that is pretty interested in social welfare, but we have elections coming up, and that means there won't be much campaign money. But then I thought, so if airports are locked, how are we surviving, right? And I'm not calling for a normalizing of this. I'm not calling for seeing this as disturbingly, quote unquote, as the new normal. But maybe this is a time in which we might have to strategize within this period to think of, oh, what's working and what do we keep for us to survive?
Completely, Nao. And thanks again for both of your contributions there. And we'll move on in the interest of time to our next two speakers. They're going to be Robert McRuer and Marina Vischmidt. We'll start with Marina, if we may. Marina is a writer, editor, and educator. Her work has appeared in South Atlantic Quarterly, Ephemera, After All Journal of Cultural Economy, and Australian Feminist Studies and Radical Philosophy, amongst many others, as well as a number of edited volumes. She is the co-author of Reproducing Autonomy and the author of Speculation as a Mode of Production, Forms of Value, Subjectivity in Art and Capital. She is one of the organizers of the Center for Philosophy and Critical Thought at Goldsmiths and a member of the Marxism and Culture Collective, and is also part of Bloomsbury Academics Board for its New Perspectives on Critical Theory of Society series. Marina, if I could welcome you to deliver your paper. Many thanks.
Hey, thank you, Chris, and everyone at the Paul Mellon Center, and all the other speakers, and the two kind of incredibly compelling, fascinating talks that we've just heard. Hard to follow, but I'll try. A bit like Nao said at the beginning of their talk, I'm not going to be speaking very specifically about art, at least not until the end of the talk, in a kind of glancing way. So it's going to be kind of more, I guess, a more general reading of certain kinds of tendencies we've observed, particularly during the time of the pandemic, but also before and around it. So I guess one way I could start is with the way the experience of the pandemic has, in my observation, generalized what used to be a certain understanding of biopolitics, which was perhaps common sense in certain academic, activist, and critical domains, but less so in a broader discursive or even effective context. And what I mean by that is this notion of what happens to the individual or biological body as systemic, as institutional, as connected to and engendered by not just the evident disciplinary and governance infrastructures of gender, race, sexuality, ability, legal status, and so forth that we are perhaps familiar with from the Foucauldian paradigm, but also to the perhaps more conventionally materialist or political economic considerations, which are not at all separate or detached from the above ones, of global food production systems, logistics networks, the shredding of social safety nets and public health and so forth. So the pandemic and the management of the pandemic, or the failure of that management, made these connections very obvious and implacable, very hard to ignore, basically, from the moment, you could say, from the moment that panic buying began, or began to be sort of visible in the media, before you even had to look for any critical research or analysis on what was going on regarding the long-term background or the incredibly differential and socially embedded horrific impacts of the pandemic. And again, as Neo noted, the management of the pandemic and its economic and social fallouts, which again really just follows the existing distribution of life chances and protection in societies whose every aspect of social reproduction was defined by extreme and normalized violence against Black people, people of color, migrants, women, and trans people, as well as men whose class position lethally combined with their allocation to the first two groups. So on the one hand, it feels like the pandemic has definitely revealed the extent to which individual bodily vulnerability to harm and risk is socially produced and socially institutionalized. On the other hand, or has revealed something that was obvious to many on the wrong end of those harms and risks. On the other hand, there have continued to be discourses around the greater vulnerability of Black and Brown people to the virus, which attempt to locate this vulnerability in some extra or surplus biological dimension or some specific racialized susceptibility, some X factor, which seems quite problematic on a lot of levels, given the kind of alibi this would provide for the neglect to sadism spectrum that white racism authorizes and practices through public and private mechanisms, to an alibi enabling that to be written off as the peculiarity of or written on particular bodies. So there's clearly been a lot of debate about this, with the complexity that what seems on the face of it to be a completely reactionary and spurious suggestion can probably not be dismissed out of hand by those without the relevant biomedical knowledge, which if it does make any useful discoveries can have life-saving consequences for workers and patients. But it does seem doubtful given what we know about the validity of race as a biological marker. At the same time, there's of course a lot of emphasis on individual responsibility in some states, including US and UK, for the management of a pandemic, which is at the very least a collective action problem, as sociologists would say. Given the individual is the naturalized unit of life, social relations, and human reason in neoliberal ideology of humanity as such, in the more historical and racialized register, this is perhaps another way that the social and the biological are intertwined in a way that disavows the collective and the social in the systemic prioritization of the economic, which is exactly the systemic dimension that the emphasis on individual choice and judgment disguises, unless it's an issue of universal provision of vouchers to go to restaurants, which seems like some kind of New Yorker cartoon on what Tories think of when they hear the term UBI. But the slippage between vulnerability as a social and biological category and experience here now brings me to say a little bit about my recent research, which I'm publishing in a couple of places soon, on how this suddenly common sense status of the critical trope of biopolitics has been taken up on the left, including in contemporary art, or in culture more generally. So here I'm thinking in a more topical way of texts discussing this term left biopolitics that have been circulating in the last couple of months, such as by the Althusserian Marxist philosopher Panayotis Sitiris, which basically translates some of the feminist arguments around self-determined social reproduction and the political implications of the networks of mutual aid that were so active during lockdown in some parts of Europe and the US, also here, into this Foucauldian vocabulary of biopolitics, and harken back as well to the breakfast programs and other social betterment and collective self-provision initiatives run by liberation movements in the 20th century, such as the Black Panthers, to take the best known example. But I'm also thinking of the turn to a vocabulary per se of bodies, which pervades activist and cultural discourse from art and curatorial theory, such as the Parliament of Bodies in 2017's Documenta as one of the early and most visible examples, to the political vocabularies of the anti-racist, queer, and feminist left. So this is something I try to analyze in the work I was just referring to, my work, and try and tease out some dimensions of what it could mean or how it could mean culturally and politically. So in some ways, it's part of a turn to affect, to the somatic, as the ground of political legibility and political possibility, echoing in some ways new materialist and object-oriented discussions in the academy, in the determination to go beyond linguistic, symbolic, and even the dominance of psychoanalytic narratives that privilege the kind of split subject structured famously in Lacan's terms, like a language, in its unconscious and its desires. In this sense, the discourse of bodies tries to override the consumerist individualism that is the default of conceiving of the person, so to speak, in the abstract in contemporary capitalist societies. At the same time, I would suggest that there's an ambiguity there because the individual, thus conceived and normalized, is not so much a linguistic or a rational individual necessarily, although the rational choice theory of markets continues to be very much in effect in policy, design, and politics, neoliberal politics. But then, of course, so does behavioral economics and all the disciplines and popular notions of the person as a bundle of quantifiable affects and data, frequently communicated by and elicited from their bodies, as with Fitbits and other such self-quantifying devices. So my question that, I guess in this super concise formulations here, my question is really whether the self-proprietorial, self-owning individual that is the model of the neoliberal human, the consumer, can, and perhaps less benign definitions, of course, can be avoided politically or ideologically, whether we actually do get to a more collective and connected place through the use of the language of bodies, or whether that is trying to get to a level of concreteness that perhaps sidesteps the powerful forces of social abstraction that turn us into isolated, helpless, suffering bodies in the eyes of capital and the state, at the hands of capital and the state, just as the pandemic has made so blindingly clear. So that's it for me. Thanks.
Many thanks, Marina, for the incisive commentary about the current moment. I think we have lots to talk about there, but I'll move on to Robert, and I'll just introduce Robert for our audience. Robert McRae is Professor of English at George Washington University, where he teaches disability studies, queer theory, and critical theory. He is the author, most recently, of Crip Times, Disability, Globalization, and Resistance for NYU Press in 2018, which focuses on the UK and examines the ways in which disability is an under-theorized component of a global austerity politics. He is also author of The Crip Theory, Cultural Signs of Queerness and Disability, which was published in 2006, as well as numerous other books and articles, including with Anna Mallow. He is co-editor of Sex and Disability, which was published by Duke in 2012, and with David Bolt, the general co-editor of a 6-volume series, A Cultural History of Disability, which comes with Bloomsbury this year. And it's a volume which covers antiquity to the modern age. Robert, you join us from Bogota. Delighted to have you with us. And also very much looking forward to seeing this book that's coming out. If you could begin your paper, what do you think?
All right, hola, gracias a todos y todas, Chris and everyone. I'm gonna share my screen and then begin. So hopefully this will work. Share. And then. Okay. I like my title for these brief remarks quite a bit, Disability Art on Lockdown, and it hopefully fits well for the theme of our conversation today, which is whose body. But let me say at the outset that there's no way that I can live up to the promise of the title because it's too soon to know all the amazing ways in which disability art on the current lockdown is being generated. My conclusion today will basically just list some of that amazing art for you. My opening slide here is showing a virtual meeting hosted by Dance New York City last month as part of their Artists Are Necessary Workers series. And just quickly clockwise from upper left, you see Christopher Unpez Verde Nunez, who is a visually impaired dancer, queer Costa Rican immigrant to New York City, Pittsburgh-based artist Dustin Gibson, who is an activist and artist working at the intersections of disability, race, and class. Alice Shepard, who I would say is one of the most important dancers in the United States today. You can find her on Instagram with the name Wheelchair Dancer. Brandon, who is the ASL interpreter for the event, and Simi Linton, author of My Body Politic and producer and subject of the disability documentary Invitation to Dance. The theme of this session was disability. The theme of the session was disability justice as the vanguard of recovery thinking. And there was a lot of debate during it about whether recovery, rejuvenation, reinvention, or other words would be the most appropriate. Yesterday, the word that was being debated was resetting, especially resonating with Barbara's talk. But my title today, Disability Art on Lockdown, also arguably has a double valence, as it's meant to gesture to the ways in which disability and art have been increasingly on lockdown, even before the current crisis that we are living through, facing massive cuts from governments everywhere. My work on disability and art in both in my most recent book and in the one that is germinating now has been pivoting toward disability justice in Latin America. My recent book, pictured here, as Chris has suggested, has read the last decade of global emergency as what I have termed crypt times. My argument has been that in our moment, disability is a central but under-theorized component of a global austerity politics. And Akka's talk yesterday actually was quite interesting in this regard. It's so ironic that this ongoing invisibilization of disability is happening now in the middle of an actual health pandemic. I'll assume, especially with an audience largely based in the UK, that I don't need to really gloss austerity as a key word. You'll see something almost every week at the moment suggesting that austerity is done. But this crisis, I would say, is showing us nothing, if not how deeply entrenched it already was. And that's regardless of what Boris Johnson and others might say about the future, with millions of people in the United States losing their healthcare because of the crisis, with disabled children and seniors doing online fundraisers for the NHS in the UK because of how the NHS has been open to business models, and on and on. My book focused both on very particular locations where such an austerity agenda was quickly imposed following the global financial crisis of 2008, and on locations where that logic was already deeply sedimented. Crypt Times thus first centers specifically on the particularly punishing austerity regime in one location, the regime that has been in place in the UK for a decade. This slide shows the disability artist Liz Crow, a performance piece that she did on the banks of the Thames called Figures, where she was using sculptures to represent lives in the UK lived at the sharp edge of austerity. But the book also spins out to a range of other locations, considering the ways in which disabled and crip, queer, feminist artists and activists creatively resist a logic of austerity. So for here, I'm putting before you a slide that is the work of Livia Brodwansky, who is a Mexico City-based photographer. This is part of a global project that was called El Museo de los Desplazados, the Museum of the Displaced, which drew attention to the processes of displacement and whose body is displaced. Crypt times, the phrase, is thus also a multivalent phrase pointing towards hard times, bleak times, precarity and suffering, but also towards vibrant cultural production and activist and artistic resistance that has emerged across borders out of or in excess of a logic of austerity, and gesturing thus towards generative collective forms of disabled thought, what Mary Lisa Johnson and I have called cripistemologies. And if you were here yesterday, Rahana's talk also was gesturing towards the need for different sorts of epistemologies. On lockdown, we really need such crepistemologies more than ever, and indeed many disabled people already had these skills to teach non-disabled people. As one immune compromised and autistic student of mine said back in March, as instruction went online, "I already live in a world whose dangers I have learned to be wary of and in which I have developed alternative and collective forms of communication." All of us need these disabled or crip ways of knowing. Again, this really resonates with Akka's presentation yesterday. The book also put forward a repeated double move that I think has relevance for the time of coronavirus and disability art on lockdown. It's a double move whereby neoliberalism spectacularizes disability. And this is a photo op, of course, from the most watched Paralympics in history, the 2012 London Paralympics. So the move looked at how neoliberalism, the book looked at how neoliberalism spectacularizes disability in ways that obscure or actively cover over the actual suffering of disabled lives in a given location. So at the time of this particular photo op outside the stadium, disabled activists were protesting the fact that ATOS, one of the sponsors of the Paralympics, they were protesting the fact that the company was finding thousands of disabled people in the UK fit to work, quote unquote, and thus ineligible for benefits. I've been thinking in this context a lot about Brazil, which is still imagining one of the most socially regressive austerity regimes in the world, leading to a horrible neglect and loss of services alongside, as in many other places, the possibility of forced institutionalization. In this context, which already spectacularized some disability identities, most notably over the past decade during the World Cup and again during the Paralympics, in this context, Jair Bolsonaro has used his own disabilities, first acquired during the presidential campaign when he was stabbed. He's here pictured in the hospital overcoming disability. These disabilities have been used to cover over again the bleak situation for disabled people in the country. It remains to be seen, of course, how his own COVID diagnosis will play into the double mood that I am tracing. So I'm interested in what disability justice looks like in this moment of danger, particularly in Latin America. It's difficult to talk about disability justice thoroughly in the time that I have, but I will note that it is a concept developed in the United States by disabled people of color, such as Patty Byrne, Leroy Moore, and others, largely members of the dance troupe Sins Invalid. And I'm putting a slide before you of Sins Invalid performers Nev Bianco and Antoine Hunter. The concept of disability justice is meant to move beyond mere inclusion. So think here again of the Paralympics photo op, and beyond a mere rights-based model. It centers the work and leadership of disabled people of color and immigrants. It thus crosses borders, it is intersectional, and it is actively anti-capitalist, given capitalism's potential to domesticate some disabled lives and debilitate others. My sense, as I get my new project off the ground, is that the project of disability justice is thriving in and around Latin America, but that it is simultaneously everywhere embattled. Brazil is just one location where disability cuts and cuts to the arts have been draconian and have worked in tandem. But where and how can we see, in conclusion, this disability justice working on lockdown in our moment? So the members of Sins Invalid themselves continue to generate critical work, especially in the context of the Black Lives Matter moment, with Leroy Moore in particular, drawing attention to how police violence often targets particularly disabled people of color. In this context, you can think of how "I Can't Breathe" is actually a statement that is a disability statement that attests to how often police violence is directed against disabled people of color. In Mexico City, Teatro Ciego, the Theater of the Blind, is a dance troupe that has gone online during coronavirus, taking their vision of different sensory perceptions and dance to a new medium, and also offering not just dance, but comedy during a time of coronavirus with their performance, Los Ciegos También Lloran, Blind People Also Cry. Christopher Unpez Verde Núñez, who I talked about in the beginning, part of the roundtable that I opened with, he's pictured here on the screen, both before and after lockdown, was generating alternative forms of movement and perception, but also in a way that in his art works to center queer and immigrant, including undocumented lives and movement. Finally, the last example that I'll put before you, Estella Laponi is a Sao Paulo-based artist who has put forward online encounters between her body and a guitar, such as in the recent Selfish Camera, Born to Be On Live, which is pictured for you here. The performance here is born out of the artist's perception of the need to reinvent her artistic work on COVID-19's time. Her gaze as a dancer and performer has turned quite a lot to the frame of the screen, to the perspectives in space, and to the disconcerting and dizzy movement of the selfie camera due to the portability of the cell phone. She carried out some experiments at home here, which culminated in Selfish Camera in collaboration with guitarist and musician Larinia Morini. Like Nunez, Laponi too offers provocative and necessary ways of navigating the world otherwise. In the Brazilian context, however, she has found it difficult to place her work during lockdown. These are just a few examples of many artists offering in this moment of emergency other ways of perceiving and knowing, essential workers who are deeply engaged in disability justice and in imagining and inventing the world that might come next. Thanks.
Huge thanks, Robert, for covering both the UK and South American perspective there. It's very interesting to see both sides of that and to kind of try and pick apart or think through those two different cultures and histories. I see we have one question already.
I'm
from
not Jeff. Hearing you.
Oh, are you not? Can everyone else hear me? Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Julia Smith asks Marina, thank you for an incredibly perceptive overview. Do you see any political openings / possibilities at all in the effect-orientated landscape you map? I wonder if you have any thoughts to that.
I mean, I guess affect was part of the landscape. I was kind of thinking about how affect and a focus on bodies both mark a particular kind of tendency in the way we think of ourselves as political subjects. Or as political collectives. And I guess I wanted to really quickly kind of sketch out what I saw as the kind of ambiguities of that, both kind of conceptually and politically. I would say the possibilities are maybe precisely in the sense that we see our bodies as these kinds of both kind of spaces where kind of larger systemic and infrastructural effects happen. And also, yeah, I guess as produced by those systems and not kind of prior or sort of more like prior or authentic to those systems, but produced through those systems, which then experienced them as part of our own kind of personal and physical experience. So I think the whole kind of coverage and analyses, different kinds of analyses from journalistic to theoretical to activist and kind of the movements, of course, that actually have come up, which are centering life as a political problem, life as a systemic, political, differential, structural problem. I think that is the kind of hopeful or optimistic aspect, as opposed to kind of feeling isolated, vulnerable, weak, exposed body. So I think both the kind of fact of the pandemic, its management, and also the recent movements, the movement for Black Lives, are kind of very much bringing the body back into as a kind of collective political actor. So I would say, again, in practice, in praxis, rather than as a ground of testimony, experience, kind of isolation, that's where I see the kind of positive dimensions of what we are exposed to understanding, as well as what we're exposed to understanding, as well as what we're exposed to with the current movements, but also with the sweep and kind of scale of, with the pandemic, its management, and the sweep and scale of the movements that have recently, and the uprisings that have recently started to resurge after kind of being minimized for a while.
Naya, I could see you engaging there. Did you have any comments to make to Marina or should we?
Of course, I mean, I'm agreeing with Marina, and it's such an important, I was just saying in the chat earlier that this connection, or the dangers of bringing the body back and this separation as for instance, when I speak of blackness, where it feels like it's a separation of the black body from the human body and what the implications of that is. But then from Marina, speaking of this bringing back of the body in the conversation in relation to the state and as a site for capitalist activity, I think it's really interesting to just see what we make, the body as a collective rather than the body as a biological entity and what that means. But then, as I was saying, if we go into queer theory or to some extent into disability studies, then the body becomes quite biological as much as it is, you know, kind of a mode of sociality. It becomes also very biological and at a risk of our exceptionalism. So yeah, basically, Marina, thanks. Thank you so much.
Robert, I wondered if you had any take on that in terms of, as you said, disability justice, but also in a sense then the idea of a collective and how that is then pieced apart through artistic practice, such as the ones you outline.
I missed because I hit mute as I moved my phone where I was reading the paper off the computer screen. I missed the beginning of what Marina was saying as she was answering a question. So I'm not sure if you're asking me about that in particular, but I have lots of thoughts about both today and yesterday about how sort of collective forms of disabled thought can give us ways of navigating the current crisis. I was really struck yesterday about how Akka was stressing how everyone in the world is talking about this new situation that we're in, and Akka was saying, well, actually disabled people have been thinking in these ways for so long. And so what I wanted to stress was how instead of stressing newness, we might learn from disabled artists, disabled thinkers, disabled people who have had these modes of knowledge for so very long. But if I'm not speaking to something that Marina said, I'd love to hear again what I was muting.
No, I think that answered something what I was interested to hear from you. I don't know if Marina has any following up thoughts, but I wonder also, I think for me, from my perspective in the art world, I can't help but notice to me what seems like a lack of disability work. I think it's actually become more and more pronounced, the absence. For me, I see less of it in recent years than I think maybe it seems like a period of the 80s, and it's kind of, in a way, it's kind of moved away, you know, certainly from parts of the art world that I go to, or more sort of, you know, that's more sort of mainstream. And I think it's incredibly important to actually address that absence, but also particularly, as you said, in the light of the pandemic, and the fact that actually these conversations aren't being addressed through those voices is, as you say, incredibly shocking in a way.
I would say, just to follow up on that, I mean, I think that what disability artists often face is a perceived disconnect between those two words when they go together, disability art. And so Estela, for instance, in Brazil, really, as we were talking, getting ready for this presentation this week, she was talking about how important it is for her work to be seen as art and for the term disability not to trump art in a negative way. And so for me, it's really important to put those together and see disability as a way of reconceiving art, and art also as a way of reconceiving disability.
Just Does anyone else have any comments? Oh, here we have Neo. Any thoughts on disability not being seen as spectacle? It's from Neo.
I mean, the point that I was making about this double move is that a certain kind of neoliberal spectacularization of disability is sort of happening everywhere. And it often happens, as my examples were suggesting, through sport. So the Paralympics, the World Cup, and so forth, put forward a disability identity that again obscures the fact that actual disabled people are suffering so much. Can disability art be part of that process? I think absolutely. I think capitalism is so capable of vampirizing anything that it's entirely possible that disability art will be part of that spectacularization that obscures what's actually happening with disabled bodies. However, I do think that forms of crip art globally are in some ways really resistant to those forms of spectacularization and commodification, in some ways much more than global queerness, which has kind of been co-opted so easily. So I guess the answer would be disability and art can totally be part of spectacle that covers over what's actually happening. But I think disability and art can put forward alternative forms of spectacle that might be less, that might be more resistant to commodification.
And just following up from Julia Smith, she asks you, Robert, from an excellent intervention, what do you think crip etymologies has to bring to art criticism / art history?
That's such a big question, and I hope my fellow panelists will also have thoughts on it. But if crip etymologies are sort of disabled ways of knowing, then I would hope that to art criticism and art history, crip etymologies are constantly putting forward sort of alternative ways of perceiving. So Teatro Ciego, for example, in Mexico City, it's like, well, one thinks of dance as almost entirely this visual art form. But Theater of the Blind in Mexico City is basically putting forward the presumption at the beginning that of why do we have to start with that idea that visuality is the center of dance. So I guess just sort of alternative ways of perceiving, alternative ways of navigating the world, alternative ways of motion are what crip etymologies would bring to art criticism and art theory.
I see Lana's just added here, can Marina and Robert maybe speak a bit more about the relationship between individual and collective subjects in their papers? Marina said something about towards the end about the self-proprietal subject, and Robert pointed to spectacularization, which you just alluded to, which would relate to individual specialization. The language of bodies and activism, such as struggles around the protest at Paralympics, engage a collective subject in different, more or less concrete ways. I would be interested to hear more on this and the relation of the concrete to the individual slash the collective. Thank you both for very interesting papers.
Should I go first? I think maybe the kind of background question is when we discuss ourselves, talk about our political subject, our existence as political subjects in terms of bodies rather than in terms of people or groups or anything else, which already starts with a collective dimension. I think there's a reference to the experience of the world that can also be intensely personal as well as collective. And the political moment is how does that personal experience translate to a collective and then back? So it's a kind of constant reciprocal movement. And that's the kind of movement of politics, basically, is like relationship of the individual to the social. I guess the kind of question I was trying to develop there is whether there's a dimension of kind of a sort of isolation to the idea of an individual body, which doesn't get overcome by the language of bodies, because it can just be a sort of aggregation of individual bodies. And the question of proprietorship was, I mean, this is maybe something Fred Moten has written about a little bit, which I didn't get to bring into the piece that I'm publishing. but kind of referring back to Hortense Spiller's on the flesh versus the body as two ways of thinking about somatic experience, or the somatic as a kind of target of violence, of differential racialized violence. So the body is a kind of self-contained, self-owning individual in a sense, in that schema, in that argument. And the flesh is kind of what happens when there's this kind of process of deprivation of gender, of humanity, and the consequent sort of targeting for exploitation, violence, oppression, abuse that comes with that. So I guess what I was thinking is whether this ownership relation is sufficiently thematized when we think of the political dimension of bodies. That's maybe something I would like to explore further in writing I haven't done yet, as well as the kind of discussion that Neo was alluding to with kind of the naturalization of a body in some queer theory, which I also have to get more familiar with. But yeah, that was, I think, enough in terms of me trying to speculatively access those terms. Yeah.
This is a great question to think through and with. And I would stress, first of all, that there have certainly been disability movements, especially in the United States, that have been really focused on individualism and independence and have drawn on problematic US traditions of independence and individualism. But at its best, the disability movement is always about stressing a collective subject. So the watchword of the global disability movement is nothing about us without us. And so that phrase of us and sort of focusing on collectivity in that very watchword is so important and has arguably sort of spearheaded other movements. So nothing about us without us, or nada sobre nosotros sin nosotros, in Spain, for example, ended up spearheading the anti-austerity movement. So nothing about us without us became sort of they don't represent us. And so the disability movement in Spain, focusing on a sort of shared vulnerability, ended up being passed to activists in general resisting austerity and saying we're all vulnerable and let's collectively put forward that us that might do something to change the world.
Thank you, Robert, and thank you, Marina. I think in interest of time, we should move on and move to Jade. Jade, patiently been there. Hello. Are you sharing a film with us? Or are you planning, do you wish to speak beforehand, or should I just...
I'll just quickly speak beforehand. I'll try and be really quick in my speaking.
Let me introduce you first, if I may. Jade Montserrat is a recipient of the Stuart Hall Foundation Scholarship, which supported her PhD race representation in Northern Britain in the context of the Black Atlantic Creative Practice Project. She's been awarded one of two Jerwood Student Drawing Prizes in 2017 for the project No Need for Clothing. Jade's Rainbow Tribe project, a combination of historical and contemporary manifestations of Black culture from the perspective of Black diaspora, is central to the production of her work, which includes her 24-hour performance review for the Spill Festival in October 2018. Recent solo exhibitions include at the Blue Coat in Liverpool, Hull's Humber Street Gallery, and she was commissioned by Art on the Underground to create the 2018 Winter Night Tube cover, and is this year's Innova and Manchester Art Gallery future collective project. So there we go. And Jade, here we go. Over to you.
Just quickly, when you mentioned the bio, I would like to dedicate my allocated time today. Thank you all, and thanks for amazing papers before. Great to meet you all. I'd like to dedicate today my contribution to Sarah Reed, who I tried to dedicate an aspect of that work too at the time, and you can see that's online. I would like to play a film from YouTube that I've just that's just gone live with Scarborough Museums Trust, a local museum and gallery, but also I'd really like to mention just that I'm finding Francis Ryan's book on disability invaluable at the moment, and her Twitter feed. I also would like to briefly mention, we were discussing artists, and I'd really like to mention Tammy Reynolds. And also I'm taking a lot from Mia Mingus, who works with Adrienne Marie Brown and others. The film and my work, I suppose I'm always exploring, sorry, I don't have a paper as such, but I just want to mention some of these things. A codification in gradiating scales of humanization and trying to negotiate where I sit and my experiences within that. And my work is seeking to work through what a ethics of care in an art context is, given that we're all familiar with the fact that so many bodies are expendable outside of, within, and within the industry. I'm just going to quickly put in some links to the chat, which go further into my understandings of blackness in terms of expendable, disposable bodies, and also a recent article that I wrote collectively and was published in Arts Professional in the last week or so, that sets out some of my peers' understanding of bodies working in, for want of a better word, the gig economy that Neo was mentioning, and beyond. The film I play is called Chronicle IA. I'll try and not play it all, but I'd like to show you a little bit. And I was thinking when I first made it, or was first coming to make it, about Eve Sedgwick's idea of reparative reading. I'll play it. Share screen.
A red light illuminates a hallway seen from a The camera moves towards the segment of the open door and walks through into the dark room beyond the hallway. Glimpses of light become visible beyond. As the camera edges forward, through the blackness, we see through a window and dawn is breaking. The curtains are opened and the expanse through the window is clearer and wider. Corners of suburban roofs and foliage from trees and bushes are in silhouette. The sky is pale blue with smudges of orange on the horizon and indigo blue clouds brood above. The conversation takes place between Jade Montserrat and Andrew and Caitlin Webb Ellis over four Zoom meetings from their respective homes.
I've just pressed record. I'm terribly sorry. I just want to say a content warning. Later on, it's not actually 14 minutes long, it's 10 or something. But there are some images of colonial atrocities from our local museum, Scarborough Museums Trust. They're taken at the end of the 19th century, mid to 19th century, I believe.
We walk with the camera into a front garden and down onto a wayward lawn, kempt by a scythe.
It just broke up when you said that.
Just try and close some windows here.
As the camera pans upward, a double rainbow comes into focus.
Oh yeah, that's a good idea. I can do that too.
Jade is a brown woman with African heritage hair. Over the course of the meetings, her hair is worn sometimes in an afro and sometimes in plaits.
Sorry, this is...
Andrew is a white man who often wears a chain around his neck and t-shirt. Caitlin is a white woman. She wears tie-dye t-shirts.
Like, glitch out, like... You know how when you're on Zoom, that happens? In dreams now, just in normal conversation. Yeah, it's...
extraordinary. Oh my God.
The, like, conditions of this time seep in subconsciously.
Is this, like, there's a bit of frustration and a bit of nervousness, cause, and a bit of, like, yeah, when somebody is speaking and you can't get the whole sentence, and you're just trying to make it up as well, like trying to figure out what it could be that they're saying. Why? You're having digital dreams.
The camera is recording a walk and looks behind the direction of travel to catch another glimpse of the rainbows. We are walking towards the sunrise on the North Sea's horizon. A fence runs the length of the path on the left-hand side of the frame.
And then when 60,000 people are dead and a disproportionate amount are disabled, elderly, and black and brown people, that's a unique project. And so if then people are saying, well, the government's saying it's okay. Well, when is it that we claim our own, when is it that we rebel then? Or when is it that we say no?
The camera points towards an expanse of sea. In the middle of the frame is a fishing boat. The overall light is pink tinged. We zoom in on the boat. Seagulls sit on the surface of the water. That's so good. The camera pans wildly from a small dark wood table with a laptop sat atop, open and facing Jade, showing a tab open with Jade's Gmail. Jade is in the study and is attempting to angle a video camera in her hand to point towards her laptop.
But what would you do if somebody was challenging your role as filmmakers, as artists, and was saying it's non-essential, and then you say, but what about music? And they say, you're not a musician.
I think that, I mean, there's always the argument that artists are making sense of the world, that in a way we're, you know, that when we look back throughout any period in history and prehistory, we look to the art of the time to give us a sense of the human condition. And I just think it's hard because people get so caught on that usefulness, like the kind of functionality of what we do, and it's hard to argue that point.
Yeah, because I thought I'm going to just quickly share my screen again.
Jade shares her screen, and the two layers of images, the screen share and a background, become transparent. The bottom layer shows Caitlin and Andrew filmed in profile.
But at some point it would be really good to. I got out this from the Harrison collection as well. I'm not sure if I sent it you.
She enlarges this document and the image of Ange and Kate fades out.
But it's not something looking at Harrison.
Under the centralised title script is a reproduction of an old photograph of Colonel James Harrison. He has a handlebar moustache.
And knowing a little bit around what he's about. I'm not sure it's something I would like to embark on by myself. So I wondered whether you'd consider like us just like reading at intervals, you know, from that.
A photographic slideshow from the Harrison collection plays in the upper right-hand corner. Jade continues to open up small window views of random photographs taken from one of the Harrison collection files. Jade angles the camera in the study and it shows her face up close behind a screen of garden cut pink and red roses in a bowl. She places her nose into the roses, sniffs deeply, and rotates the bowl to show the roses to the screen.
Metal prongs for the metal prongs, and it just kind of slides on, well, fits on the bottom and pushes up kind of thing.
Caitlin and Andrew are teaching Jade how to use a handheld camera over Zoom.
Perfect. Looks right. And then did it just come on?
No, there's another battery here.
I think if you close the screen and then open it again, it should.
There is another, oh.
Is it? Yeah, there you go, it's on.
Perfect.
maybe that's enough. I'm not sure. I think we're well over time.
Yeah, thanks, Jade. I think that was a good time to maybe draw close to that film. And I think you can watch it. It's available online, so people can watch the rest of the film after the talk. Thanks again for sharing it. It's a wonderful, it covers so many parts of your life and also the kind of, the sort of archive of Colonel Harrison as well. Was your decision to, was that a decision to share that labor of looking at that work? Was that part of the reason to work with these two artists?
Yeah, there's only so much capacity we all have. And I think also Scarborough Museums Trust, I've lived here all my life. They've rolled out that taxidermy collection all my life and no mention of Colonel Harrison. And I think it's a collection, the context is something that's been hidden in plain sight. And I think that that's what we're seeing when we're talking about invisibilized bodies or marginalized bodies. There's the absence I have needs, part of the essentials that I'm kind of interested in trying to draw together our collective essentials is that I've known physical isolation most of my life, definitely in the foremost years of my life, and not having mains electricity or neighbours or family, or and being in a totally white environment for most of my life, including, you know, when I get to university at Courtauld, etc. So I think I'm now able to say what I need, and in the absence of any staff at Scarborough Museums Trust who are of colour, or is a particularly sort of ableist and white middle class environment, I need to speak with people who are at the very least sort of, and I'm kind of sort of erring away from the idea of allyship, but Webb Ellis generously, definitely in solidarity as we consider justice, anti-racist justice, and what the broader implications of that in terms of anti-capitalism. I think, yeah, yesterday I saw that Mia Mingus had put up, you can't be an anti-racist if you're not anti-capitalist. So I really needed, I need to maintain my energy reserves, and actually I can fall back a little bit on the labour of Web Ellis. And I think that they'd be okay with me saying that.
Does anyone have any questions about Jade's work? I would quickly like to ask Jade, is then for you making work an act of care itself? And is it something you see as part of that practice of self-care and self-acknowledgement? Are these two things connected for you?
Yeah, and actually I'm almost reaching the end point of like trying to reply to emails at the moment. And I feel a bit emotional in that I hope that I will be able to resume making. I'm not carving out time at the moment for that as much as I'd like to, but for different commissions or different activities or workshops that I'm able to participate in or facilitate. There's a hospital field one coming up on Monday. And in preparation for that, I will work through some drawings, but everything's like for something. And I know that many of my queer, trans, peers of colour who are speaking with me at the moment are saying, you know, like, and I would agree, but somehow I think, was discussed before, I've lived in an isolated environment, so I have resources that I have had to use for survival that haven't gone away. But in answer to your question, what I'm hearing is that there are commissioning opportunities, but that there's an outcome required. And actually what people really, really need to maybe consider is that the connection between our mental health and our health and creativity is totally interlinked. You can't separate it. And I think I think my peers, and I don't want to be speaking for anyone else, but it would be, I've always been, again, sort of art for art's sake, but like, why not? Actually, people have done that. And maybe I would like to do that. I would really like to, in my lifetime, what I'm working towards is to, not in any facetious way, but I really want to paint do botanical paintings. I just want to paint, but I also maybe want to make a film, or I don't know, like, yeah, it's really healing, just like the garden is, or being by the sea is part of us, and it's a connection between us. And I think that that's what's so upsetting when the arts are marginalized, and yet they, in the capitalist world, it generates so much money. There just seems to be a dissonance that I can't get my head around. And also I haven't eaten yet.
I'd like the audience and everyone watching to start thinking about final questions, and of course our panelists as well, to start maybe thinking of some maybe final thoughts. But Jade, I also wanted to ask you, because I think your work has such a specific relationship to language, you know, from the way you draw to actually even in that video, the voiceover and the sort of the way in which you describe the images that we are seeing. I wondered if you could talk a little bit about what language constitutes for you as a very material body and what that body might mean for you.
I hope I can answer this. I'm not sure. I'll try. I think, I was speaking yesterday on the phone to somebody who provides books for young women. And we spoke for the first time, and she spoke about my accent. I know you've asked specifically about language, but I be- But I remember when I first went to university and I had some sort of existential crisis because I couldn't recognize my voice. And it's weird that I'm actually holding my hand in front of it, because it does feel like an object of like different influences. And I am now performing those, the impact of certain education and an environment. So for me, I'm constantly trying to review my own use of language. And also I'm joining ways of expressing together through this collective that I feel I'm a part of, with you, Chris, and with all of you on the panel and beyond, that our language and our bodies are connected and can be united, but there is a dissonance often given where we stand on the margins. So I have to speak a certain language to be heard, or the way that I articulate has to be shaped for a certain audience, just like a certain audience, if you want to say it that way, or a gaze, has determined that I'm a racialized body. So I wouldn't have had a language for that up until a certain point in my life, until it was made clear that that was who I was. So I'm trying to speak, and it's hard for all of us.
Thank you, Jay, for that observation. As also someone from Liverpool, I relate to your initial reaction to having an accent. And my accent, similarly, I've had to... Well, anyway, that's a different story. Anyone else have any thoughts or final ruminations that they'd like to share with the group? Lana, are you still with us? I see your cameras. Are you there, Lana?
I am, but I don't know why it won't let me put my camera back on. I think it says the host hid me, and I just really enjoyed hearing Jade talk about it, and also enjoyed seeing the film, and it feels incredibly kind of, it just feels very resonant. It's really interesting to see a work that captures a lot of what our experience has been on screens over, I've been asked to start my video. Hello, everyone. It captures a lot of just some of the strange physical sensations or auditory sensations of sitting in front of a screen all day and speaking to people on screens. And it's just really interesting to see a work, to see that kind of solidified or concretized in some way in a work. So that's all I wanted to say, really. But thank you, Jade.
Yeah, and I think also all the glitching and the kind of disruption that is part of that film is very, I mean, it's such a kind of, it's reflective of all of our experiences and the experience that we're having today, you know.
Yeah.
So sort of.
I've just put it in the chat. Thanks. The link is there.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone? See, we've got any more questions? I don't think we have it. Do we have any more questions, Danny, or anything from the floor? I think we've answered most questions.
I think one's in the Q&A box, yes, but no raised hands.
Yeah. Lizzie Helmershan asks, I feel like there's not time, although there is, but what Jade just said about speaking was so interesting, and maybe it would be interesting to think about this in relation to Marina's passing comment about Lacan and the unconscious being structured like a language. Any thoughts on Lacan, Marina?
No, that was really just a passing reference. just as a kind of something that a lot of contemporary theory and politics would maybe want to move away from, I guess. But at the same time, the idea of language maybe the other idea of language being material, which I think has been what we've been talking about for the last few minutes, is I think maybe not something that should be, like, language should maybe not be bracketed or sidelined entirely, but maybe our approach to it can be transformed, whether theoretically or otherwise, as a material process.
And I guess to an extent, trying to maybe build, you know, what Lizzie maybe is sort of referring to as well is the sort of the language that appears in Jade's work and this sort of the narrative or this unconscious structuring of the way we look and the way we observe. I think that is certainly true in Jade's practices. Yeah.
I think, sorry, you meant about like the work that I do like on paper and how I maybe do it in the thing. Sorry, I veered off into something. Sorry.
No, I think, in terms of language in your work, Jade, I think it's both, in both of the things that you're describing, both the material drawings that you use and this, the way in which you performances that you make in relationship to those drawings, but also then in this, the instance of this film. Yeah.
Thanks, Verena.
Final comments, anyone? Any final thoughts, we can start wrapping up. Okay, well, that leaves me just to thank Jade, Neo, Marina, Robert, and Lan, and of course, Anna and Ella and Danny for organizing and being part of this talk as well. My sincere thanks, and to say thank you for being here. This is the end of the 2 days, and hopefully we'll be able to expand and develop these in other ways going forward. Many thanks and goodbye.
Thank you.